Well, thanks everyone. Hope you had a good breakout room, got to meet someone new or chat with an old friend. John's not with us today. He is on his way or is currently in San Francisco doing a little college tour with his son. So he won't be joining us. So you're stuck with me. And I've got some color commentary support with Catherine. And we should have a good call. So I wanted to open it up to anybody who's new to the call to introduce themselves. Let us know where you're from, what you do, and drop your information in the chat room as well. So are there any new faces on the call or any people that maybe haven't been here in a while? Dash, go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Dash Desai. I'm the founder of smallouthside.com. I've seen some of the faces on the Open Assembly. Certainly, San Rai I recognize from those sessions. Hey, San. So yeah, this is my first time on the CTW forum. I'm really looking to tune into these forums because the future of work and talent platforms is certainly an area of interest for me. I don't fully understand what CTW does, so I'm really going to tune in to understand how CTW, OpenAssembly all work together.
Sounds great. Well, welcome. Yeah, drop your information in the chat. That'd be great. Anybody else want to say hello?
Yes, I'm Jean-Yves, calling from Boston. So I was in breakout room. I don't know if it was random or designed on purpose by you, but I'm speaking French with Nelly. So I happen to be French. Been in the US since 94, in Boston since 99, a stint about 10 years in venture, in incubation of businesses and large company innovation for last 10, and helping some startups in the East Coast. So interested obviously in the future work as it relates to distributed workforce and all of that.
Great, thanks for joining. And that was not by design. I think that was just destiny. So, anybody else? Bill, why don't you say hi? Since you've missed a few calls.
I will be happy to. Hopefully you can hear me, yes?
Yeah.
Oh, great. Sorry about that. I was just putting my information in the chat. I'm Bill Trutner. I represent the Spigot crowdsourcing software with PlanView and here to continue learning lots more about crowdsourcing and future of work, and happy to contribute.
All right. Well, thanks a lot. Along the lines of sharing, anybody have some new initiatives they want to touch on? Anybody got anything super cool and awesome they want to share with the group here? Todd, you got to have something new over there. Come on.
Oh my gosh. I'm in stealth mode. I can't talk about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have something maybe.
Yeah, go for it. Thanks, Nelly.
I'm planning around the world. Conference is not a good word because conference sounds very corporate, but more like get together with like, there's a dinner and then there's a following day long of workshop about building the future of work with different speakers. And so the upcoming ones are in London in July, in Bay Area in August, and then October in New York. So if you want to join, I'm going to keep it small for the first dinner, like 40 or 50. Just send me a message on LinkedIn and I'll send you the invitation based on your city.
What's the theme?
Building the future of work. So there's going to be a mix of workplace leaders, HR people leaders, benefits, and a lot of conversation about sustainability, the way we hire and we fire, what the places or where work happen, and what is the meaning of what we all do. Why is it meaningful, this change that we're trying to push in the world of work? So that's the big theme that we'll talk about. And based on each city, it will be influenced by the speakers, the local and current situation. So that's that.
Oh, great. Anybody else have anything they want to share? Anything new coming up?
Yeah, I'll go. Go ahead.
Ladies first, Chuck. Go ahead.
Okay. Aaron.
Well, for me as a freelance engineer, the startup World has been an important part of that ecosystem in open talent, especially when you know, a startup that I'm working with gets bought by a bigger company, and that's my gateway into working with, like, say, one of my clients was Spin. They have the electric scooters. I built the headlamp for that, and then they're bought by Ford. So now my company is into Ford, and I'm an open talent gateway into Ford. So if you're interested in learning about the startup side of stuff with hardware, HardwareCon is going to be June 8th, and it's online. So normally you have to go to Silicon Valley, but you don't this year. It's online. And you go to hardwarecon.com, and if you want one of the paid tickets, you can get code oddeng. I'll put it in the comments, but for 15% off. But there's a free one too.
Oh, great. That sounds interesting. Go ahead, Chuck. Oh, you're on mute.
Just letting everybody know that I've been getting a lot of traction on an idea we have called a masterclass on the future of work for everyone. And this is the notion that we can come together in a number of different sectors and groups to offer sort of a introductory course, maybe something along the line of a $50 course that people can learn about where the future work is going to be for them, what kind of work they'll do in the future. I've just submitted the idea for an incentive challenge that's been up there. And there's a group of us on the side that have been kind of working on it as well, and beta tested it in a master's program, and it's seemed to be well received as well. So if you want to know more about the masterclass on the future work for everyone, give me a call and or connect with me on LinkedIn. I'll put my deets in the chat. Thanks.
I think we know some people at Incentive. Right, good. John?
I have an update I could share.
Yeah, go for it, Jean.
Hi, I'm Jean. This is just my second meeting, and I work at Zenefits, which is an HR tech company. And we just finished a book on the future of work as it relates to HR. It is available for pre-order, but it's we'll ship in June. I guess it is June 22nd. Anyway, so if you're looking at through the lens of HR at like how the future of work, you know, unfolds, and we were talking about this in the breakout room, but like what's expected from hiring, what's expected from recruiting, and like how companies can stay ahead, that's sort of the topic of the book. So I'll drop a link in, and if you have questions, let me know.
That's great. Yeah, we just published a podcast with Connor Heaney from CXC, and they kind of play in that space globally, so you might want to check it out.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah, I'm multitasking today, so I'll try to get that in the chat. Maybe Catherine can do it for me. Tom O'Malley just joined. Tom, we're just about to wrap up. Anything new to share with the group? You got anything new you want to?
Is it these crappy glasses, or do you have a glow around you that kind of reminds me of Sybil Shepherd from Moonlighting?
I was going for the make me look 10 years younger filter. So
it's working. Man.
Working. Yeah.
Yeah, no.
How about the makeup?
Anything new from current Tom you want to share?
Oh, there's always new, but I'm gonna save my my time on the floor. In a couple of weeks, I think we're gonna have some visual aids to show the group, and so I'll save for that.
Awesome. Great. Well, thanks everybody, and yeah, please keep dropping your information in the. John, you got something? Oh, you're on mute.
Yep, I should have been ready to unmute faster.
No problem.
I just wanted to share that there's some work that we've been doing with Habitat for Humanity and World Vision on some things that will, we believe, from their mouth to our ears, will impact tens of millions of people positively regarding sanitation, as well as resistant buildings from earthquakes and typhoons in parts of the world that are greatly impacted. So we're doing some really cool social things for the rest of the world, and a lot more things in the sustainability world with our clients. So just thought I'd share that with the group.
Yeah, thanks, John. John's with Incentive, so feel free to reach out to him through the platform. Awesome, thanks so much, everybody. We had the second session of the training for coaches and consultants yesterday, and I didn't know if anyone was on the call. Dale, you're here, and any color commentary you want to give the group about the second session and what your thoughts were, and maybe a couple take-home messages?
Yeah, it's a fantastic process. So really enjoying it. Even though I do have to get up at 2:30 a.m. in the morning to participate from here in Auckland. But one of the great things that we're doing is working with a live client, which is SEI, and looking at their particular needs and thinking really practically around what their needs are for open talent. And they've had some really interesting experience, not all good. So it's great that we're actually able to draw that out. And in teams at the moment, we're looking at how we can actually provide a quick win for them. And I think there's some really interesting outtakes around our languaging, how we're describing different open talent solutions and recognizing, you know, how to match certain solutions to specific needs more in a way that actually builds maturity within a firm as well. So, you know, you can't just jump in and hope that everything's going to work, but where can you start to get some quick wins? How do you build on that, expand that reach, and ultimately, you know, really access this abundance of talent that organizations can find? So it's a terrific process. I'm really enjoying it.
Yeah, I've been listening in. It's been great, and thanks for getting up so early in the morning to join us. And you look better than most of us on that call. You must be a morning person. So, yeah, I don't think there's anyone else on the call that was part of the training.
Hey, Dale, this is Jeff Bojar. I'd love to hear from you about SEI, and you know, you're developing the quick wins for them right now in two cohorts. I'd love to hear how unique you think SEI is. Are they like truly like a unique organization, and the quick wins you're designing are contextual to them? Or do you think that there are really themes with SEI that repeat across other enterprises that have a hope of investing in open talent strategies?
Yeah, great question. And I think there are other people, you know, instructors on the program who have a lot more experience than I do and will be seeing that patterns. But one of the things that's very interesting from my point of view, where in New Zealand we're working with, of course, much smaller organizations, is it still to me is coming back to, you know, what are those essential capabilities that are at the core? How do you actually get people, get, you know, build prepared minds? And you know, how do we build those internal processes that can facilitate that growth? So from my point of view right now, I don't see them as unique. I see that there are themes that are common. And I believe we are going to be able to provide very realistic roadmaps for organizations in terms of how to get started and how to grow quickly. And I think a real focus too on being embedded strategically. So understanding the impact, being able to measure the impact, being able to compare the effectiveness of open talent solutions with previous solutions that may have taken a very long time and cost an awful lot of money. And there was a really amazing example somebody shared, you know, just this last session around, you know, solving a problem that was going to cost $500,000 US. And it was around a process, you know, management. And a freelancer was found who was very, very skilled and did the job for $37,000. So I think, you know, we'll pull out some really good examples that are meaningful to all types of organizations.
That's great.
Thanks. And I think next session, 2 weeks from yesterday, is really all about KPIs and, you know, other triggers that can lead to broader organizational expansion of these strategies. And I know that's a place that's near and dear to Balaji's heart from Deloitte. And so I know he'll do a great job in 2 weeks you know, teaching, instructing, facilitating on that topic. Thanks, Dale. Thanks for sharing.
And Jeff, Brandon, and Catherine, this is Ashley. I'm also involved in the cohort with Dale, and I would agree with her wholeheartedly that SEI isn't a unique case study or a unique client. What's been really fascinating is that they're in a highly regulated financial services market, right? And so it's been really interesting to look at how they've been using open talent and open innovation and what platforms they're using, where they can't share client data, hard stop. So there's really, you know, we're kind of breaking down those barriers and looking at where platforms and open talent and open innovation can be a fit and where can it not be a fit. And then what projects are ripe for open talent and which ones aren't, right? So it's been a highly collaborative, very participatory experience so far. And just looking at how can they adopt the right open talent or the right open innovation approach with the right platform at the right time.
Great, Ashley.
That's great, Ashley. Thanks for sharing. I think it's a super interesting use case because they are so regulated, and it really leads you to think about like how can you use data segmentation and other tools like that to create opportunity for open talent strategies to work where you wouldn't have that problem in a less regulated environment.
So Dale, I'm curious to get your take on, obviously this is going to be a benefit to the enterprise side. How are you looking at it from the lens of the platform, if at all?
Yeah, I think, the current piece of work we're looking at how we would use Wizoku as a platform to get a quick start. And I think one of the things that's interesting from my point of view is even though we're talking about open, we're saying to get started, we're going to start with the internal crowd before we go open. And to me, that is about building the capability and the readiness. And, you know, I know for the size of organizations that I work with, we don't want to actually have lots of different platforms and marketplaces. So I think that the Wizoku platform, because it can actually engage with multiple audiences and go from something quite focused internally through into complete open innovation through an incentive is a really a good match. And I think the other insight is how the platforms are taking the heavy lifting out of the process and really supporting the execution process. So there are lots of questions, and not just from SEI, but I get this all the time around, we don't want just lots of ideas and lots of stuff to have to work through, but the platforms are helping work through to surface the best ideas, but actually then helping with the execution process and accelerating that. And I don't think we've really got that across yet, but I think that taking the heavy lifting out of the process is a real benefit that is kind of yet to be realized.
Yeah, for sure. Anybody have any comments on that?
From my perspective, it'll be very interesting to see how responsive the regulatory environment can be in industries like power utilities, that you have NERC rules and that don't necessarily align up with some of these types of solutions. You know, we're making progress on that point, but it'll be interesting to see some of the regulatory support for these on-demand resources.
John Fredrickson, I mean, you've worked with an incentive for 14 years, and I'm just interested in your experience with regulatory, you know, highly regulated and highly regulated environments.
Yeah, thanks, Dale. Yeah, it's different. I think each industry, each case is its own use case. There are similarities. We've, you know, over the 14 years I've been here, there's some of the most incredibly sensitive issues that I could have ever imagined being expressed in challenges externally and internally in ways that have anonymized client, the intent, We did a session with a large global enterprise that looked at a list of 10 challenges, four of which were their own challenges, and the people internally at the company couldn't pick out their four in a group of 35 people. So there's a way to do it. You have to be creative. You have to be sensitive. We've done patient data that has been anonymized. We've done some pretty interesting things. So I wish there was a universal yes, it's always possible. That would be an overstatement. So each case, each company has sensitivities and in highly regulated areas, whether it's in government, financial services, pharmaceuticals, where personal information is exposed or potentially could be used. There's ways to do it that we found just through experience.
That's great. Any more comments on that? Great. Well, moving on, Catherine has a quick update on the playbook, and I'll let her take it from here. Maybe Catherine, just touch on the what the playbook is for people that are sort of new real quick, and then go from there.
Sure. Yeah, so we've been working on creating a playbook, which is basically a framework for how to engage with open talent. And sorry about that. We've been developing a playbook, which is basically a framework for how to integrate open talent into an organization. And John shared it on the call a couple weeks ago. But we've essentially built just like a very high level process for taking someone from start to finish, what it will take to create a networked organization, everything from, you know, your culture and your leadership, your organizational structure, and through a process of assessing, learning, experimenting, build, optimizing, that type of thing, just so that we can show a full flow of how an organization can get from point A to point B with using open talent. And so we're at the stage where we have kind of a draft of the playbook ready, and we've been using it to serve as the foundation for this training, this OA PCP first cohort that we've been talking about. And everyone's been giving us really good feedback. And one of the pieces of feedback that's been so amazing so far is just that we're all so close to this, that what we're finding is that there's just, you know, definition after definition that needs to be created. And it's funny because Dalen and I talked about this morning, just a few minutes ago. Things like, you know, what's the difference between open talent and open innovation? You know, we really haven't even started to peel back the layers of what some of those definitions are so that we can talk about it easily when we're having conversations with organizations. So we're in the process right now of getting feedback from the first cohort, and then we're also soliciting feedback from some of the team leads from the CTW, and then we're going to be integrating and kind of refining and munging all of that feedback back into a V1. And we hope that Team Magenta will have the next round of the playbook, or sort of the first publicly facing version of the playbook, ready by the end of this month. And then we'll be able to share it with everybody. So we're super excited.
Awesome. One of the comments that came up on the learning team was that we're going to need a glossary of terms at some point, and that there'd be a common glossary of terms across all the organization that they want to be able to do. And I'm implementing a glossary of terms for my workplace right now for the work I do. And it takes quite a bit of work actually to put an online glossary of terms together, but I think we need one in this space, and that would help with some of that language you're talking about.
Yeah, and Chuck, we'll be doing that for the playbook, which we'll have a glossary for the next version of the playbook, which will serve as our foundation, and that will evolve over time, but it's a great starting point for all of us to work from. So thank you.
You're right, Ashley, and this group could probably really help us with it. Overall, as we get something together, we can maybe Wikify it a bit so that folks can contribute.
Perfect.
Awesome.
Do you have questions about the playbook at all?
There's if you go to our blog, I'll try to grab the link. The last CTW call, John shared the deck, and you can review it there as well if you'd like to learn a little bit more about it. And then another topic of business is we have a research request, and we're trying to, as CTW and OA, we're trying to advance our new offerings to our community. So we're looking for people to participate in some research and offer some feedback. So our primary need is for enterprise leaders at the moment, but we also have some opportunities. We'll have some opportunities in the future for freelancers and platforms and consultants and academics as well. So if you have interest and you want to partake in it, we'll have a link in the chat here. Just a Google form you can fill out, and feel free to share it with others as well. We'd appreciate your help and support. So check that out if you have the time. And then I wanted to open up this conversation. I heard on NPR this morning, and then I read this article on Axios about how LinkedIn is going to, they're going to pay these global co-chairs of their employee research groups an additional $10,000 a year to really target diversity and inclusion. And there was also an article on NPR about it, how the role of the chief diversity officer is becoming more relevant in enterprise. And I wanted to kind of open it up with a question is how folks in this room think Open Talent can play a role in diversity inclusion within enterprise. And if anyone had any thoughts on that to kind of kick off the conversation.
Yeah, hey, I've been working on something and I've been sharing it with the OA and CTW group as well. But we built sort of a matchmaker tool based taking some of the CTW data and then building on that, but really to develop an MVP of what would it look like to allow talent to be able to search for what platforms are relevant to me, as well as for companies, depending on their role and depending on what kind of jobs they have to get done, being able to search that same sort of matchmaker. You know, here's, so the database is filled with about 400 different platforms, and we've just put in a basic data model, and we're still aligning folks to coordinate as we develop this out. But one of the core elements that we built into it is DEI disclosure. So what is the DEI of your company? So each company on the platform is incentivized to disclose that information, because if you disclose, no matter what it is, if you just disclose the data, you show up higher on the search result. And so we're trying to make DEI, or I believe anyway, that DEI, you know, if you think about, if this is the beginning of Work 4.0, then let's put DEI at the core of it and incentivize companies to just do that by default, disclose the DEI of their company as well as DEI of their networks. Understanding that some networks, DEI is not necessarily a factor. Like when you look at, you know, an all Japanese women's coder network, you're just not going to find, you know, a whole lot of diversity to be disclosed there. However, most platforms do, no matter where they are in the world, have some at least statement that they can make. And so that's the idea. We think that if we could align search, you know, an industry that's about ready to be aggregated and create an incentive for people, companies to benefit from disclosing their DEI, if we can make those two ideas, that Work 4.0 is about diversity, equal opportunity, you know, equitable workplaces, we're going to be better off. You could go check out the MVP site. It's at we2b, like instead of B2B, it's we2bopen.com.
We2b. You dropped that in the chat?
Yeah, I'll put that in the chat.
Great.
Looking for collaborators. There is no revenue model associated with it. We're just doing it for the hell of it. And we think that the industry needs an aggregator anyway.
Yeah, for sure. Ashley had a question about that. What did you mean by exposing their DEI?
So every profile on the, I could bring up an example if it helps you just see it.
Let me see if I have this. Yep, there we go.
So if I was to just be a professional looking for a platform and go in here, you're gonna see that, and again, this is all, there's real data behind it, but it is an MVP, that I can go into the profile of this company here and see, okay, what is from diversity, equity, inclusion, what's their statement? How do they feel about DEI? Where does it have a place in their organization and on their network? And so just disclosing those numbers moves them to the higher search result.
And how is it ranked? Is it ranked against their peers or what benchmarks?
Well, it's search filters, right? So what networks are relevant to me for, you know, I provide administration services, content services in what industry. So the database is searchable by filters, mm-hmm. but then the presentation in the MVP is either ordered by network DEI performance or employee DEI performance.
Hmm. Tom, I have a question.
Yeah.
And this is remote from what you're showing right now. Wouldn't this create bias as well? Like, for example, I am looking for a place to work. And because the DEI is exposed, I'm going to be searching. And I will say, oh, I don't want to work there because there's a bunch of this category of people. I just don't want to name what kind of category, but of course, we are talking about people as if they are crayons, which is very interesting, you know? So I have a deep sensitivity about this subject. And so I'm just kind of bringing it up right now, but I don't want to get an answer. I just kind of bringing it up. So what is the extent of what we are doing? Is it for what purpose, and would it create bias? So just a thought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's almost a rhetorical because I think everyone would answer that a bit differently. I think there is no way to present anything without bias. Whether you put the data or don't, you're creating some sort of statement, or some might feel a statement is missing. But the philosophy of this site is that disclosure and transparency is better than none. And if it's important to you to find gig employment that's aligned to your values of D&I, then this is the site for you. If it's not, that's fine. This is not built for everybody. But the idea is we think that, you know, what we see in our business is that people are doing B2B gig work. I'm not talking about like driving cars and stuff. I'm talking about selling business, either knowledge services, business services. They are doing it not necessarily to augment their income. They're doing it for higher reasons. Like I need, my job doesn't expose me to the topics that I believe are the future or I'm passionate about. And you know what? I'm not an AI expert in my job, but man, I spend all my time learning and coding on the side. I am an AI expert. And so therefore people are doing it for reasons that aren't necessarily I need to feed my children. And so values is really coming into this layer of work, unlike perhaps a core job where, look, I got to do it because I got to feed the fam. This is what we're experiencing in the B2B open talent world on the supply side, is that they want it connected to their values. And so I just believe that D&I is it may be a starting place. Maybe there's other value metrics and different ways we can cut it up, but this just seems like a really basic first MVP swing at it. And we'll, you know, we can always.
Yeah, I like it as well because I like DEI, you know, I like the purpose of it, but we could actually create it where it's not just a check mark where, okay, did we qualify? Did we have the right percentage of this kind of people in our, in just to be able to present something that is acceptable, but not really embodied within the organization? You know, it has to be where it's embodied from the core and not just a representation as a graph. Thank you.
Thanks, Mafe. And thanks, Tom, for sharing that. you know, it kind of brings up the question, does anyone have any success stories out there? Like, you know, are there any examples of where Open Talent has played a positive role within diversity inclusion within a diversity inclusion within an enterprise? Does anybody have any?
It's inherent in the nature of how this whole thing works. I mean, that's one of the, that's like the, that's like the a fringe benefit of the whole concept.
Right.
The fact that it's anonymous, I think, even makes it more so. I mean, if I have a resume in front of me and it has a name, the name alone creates bias. The address creates bias. The area code of the phone number could create bias. The beauty of Open Talent, in my experience with crowdsourcing specifically, is that I have no idea who is solving my problems. And then when I get those demographics, then I get really excited because I'm like, look at this. It was, you know, this was the blend of people that we had from all across the world, from and various genders. I mean, it's kind of, that's like the magic behind the whole thing. I'm just kind of, I'm trying to figure out, I didn't understand, Tom, what the, where are you exposing the D&I? When you say D&I, is it like the D&I policy, or is it like, what is, for example, if I were to, if Mike were here from Topcoder, are we asking Mike to say, what's your network? Like, what is the demographics of your entire network of
yeah, the only the two metrics, or? The only two metrics that one can input now is you can upload your D&I policy. You can make a statement, you know, as it comes to our employees, this is how we feel about D&I. If you're, oh, by the way, and if your policy is not, you don't have a policy, but you're going to make a promise to put one out, you can put a deadline date. And then the only metrics though are percent of color and percent of women. And as a start, again, MVP, we thought, okay, let's just start there. And I mean, we as a group are looking to get more influence as to what metrics do matter. What should matter? What is the right way to present them? So we're still in the learning phases, but that's how we think of it.
But I mean, so this, but is the target though, is this for Open Talent platforms, or you, or do you want ExxonMobil to put their D&I so perspective in there, and then like platforms aren't going to come to us because they don't like that we, you know.
This is Expedia for Open Talent. So it's an aggregation of Open Talent platforms and gig enablement software even. So just anything that's advancing Open Talent as a subject, but in particular, we're focused on attracting the Open Talent platforms that have networks of people that are, you know, the supply side of the Open Talent world.
Right.
Are the solution providers. Those are the ones that we're targeting.
Right. So it'd be like, you know, incentive, like what, tell us about your community. What's the,
exactly.
How does it?
Yeah. And they may not know. They might
in
say,
general, but it's yeah. always changing, right? I mean, you and ask Kaggle and it's always going to, it's like college students and people from around the world and yeah. a big blend of things. It's always going to be, it's an ever changing landscape. So that demo, that slice of data is always going to be different.
It is, but the statement and the approach to it, you know, your recognition that it's important and maybe the business.
I'm with that. Yeah, I'm down with that.
Yeah, you know, we estimated at these metrics, you know, or as of this date, this is what we, you know, we took a sample and this is what it's showing. But here's more importantly in the statement, you might say, but here's, you know, as Kaggle, we actively go out and try to recruit folks in these, you know, either geographies, or we have practices to support a balanced network.
Yeah, because I think the policies might differ from the data. I mean, I'm gonna
very much so.
Don't shoot me, but let's say, you know, Aaron was talking about engineering. So
yeah,
think about a field that's typically dominated by a specific gender, and so that that community may just inherently be more dominant in one gender, but that doesn't, that shouldn't
get harassing then, comments because I don't have enough women on my platform. People harass me,
but you don't necessarily have control over that, right? So your policy would be, we're completely open and we would love to have more, you know, we're gender neutral. We don't care how you identify, but it may not be within your control. So it's like, our policy is this, but here's reality.
I mean, this whole thing is, or this problem is not new, right? It happens in sustainability and product transparency, and what people have found is that is that being transparent, actually stating whether it's good or bad and not passing judgment, but it is what it is. And here is, and we either see this as a problem or we don't based on this nature, but that's why we think it's important to have both the quant and the qual there to add context to what data is presented. They're not forced to add the data. They might say it doesn't apply to us, but here's our statement, and that's fine. We want them to be rewarded for even attempting to claim their profile. And as you said, we just want this, we want to create a movement of platform players that are saying, we believe that D&I is inherent to Work 4.0. And yeah, it's going to vary all over the place, but we're going to support this idea that it should be baked in.
Some of these ideas also needed funding, right? For example, somebody who is a company that has funding for that can actually show that. For small companies that doesn't have enough money, it's not that they don't want to adopt it. It's just that they don't have the right funding for that, because the resource for a small company is not as big as like Deloitte, TopTal, and all this. So, and the reason why I'm bringing this up is because sometimes we are here and we are gathered here for a certain purpose, and yet we have not, we are actually, we may be able to have tools that actually help, because this is a very sensitive issue. Exposing that may be in the right time, but right now it's too early, because sometimes some people are scared as well. So I'm speaking in from different tangents also from where I'm coming from. So I'm just bringing that up, you know, whatever and however these words meant for this project. Thank you.
Thanks, Mafe. San, you had your hand up.
Yeah, it's thank you. I mean, it's such a complex, I mean, we probably need to do a conference just on this. And it's, you know, I think it's always easy to shortcut. So I kind of hear both sides of, you know, I don't think this is Tom's intention at all, but I do understand, you know, we saw that in NPS, right? There's a way to then kind of make numbers very performative without actually resolving to address the underlying issues. But what I was going to add, just to comment on Tom's methodology, was that what I do know from some of my behavior science friends is that the act of pledging is actually a super powerful act just in and of itself. And the act of getting leadership to make a substantial pledge, often, even if you have leadership that is, whose intention is performative, and we have a lot of that leadership, especially I think in the US, the act of pledging can even like address that inherent kind of limitation that they have. So I just wanted to kind of shout and applaud Tom on that aspect. It may not be, or it may end up being the most powerful aspect of the tool that he's building.
Thanks, San. Jeff.
Yeah, just real quick, Tom mentioned qualitative too, and a couple of things came to mind based on Rich's comments too. Collecting some case studies or histories would be very powerful. The stories would be very powerful. Eva Guinan ran a competition at Harvard Medical School back, I don't know, 8 years ago now. And one of the winners was a 22-year-old woman who didn't have her PhD, couldn't qualify for a NIH grant, but came up with a truly novel idea. So that when you anonymize the winners, you're going to get these great case studies that come out, because you're not putting a filter on, you know, who can win. Second quick point is John Fredrickson dropped off, but when we did our initial pilots, they did a really nice review of the first 7 winners that had these bios of the winners that highlighted some really great things. And, you know, we always talked about participatory exploration for NASA, and here was a great example of just that. You know, here were people who basically said right up front, gee, I never thought I could, you know, help the space program. So there's lots of other ways to get at this. You know, collecting some really good stories would help on the qualitative end.
Thanks, Jeff. Well, awesome stuff, everyone. We're about to wrap up. I wanted to share this link. So grab this real quick. This is a TED talk that Mark Hanat just gave. Love for y'all to cut and paste that into your browser, give it a watch, and share it, like it, tag it, whatever you can do to help promote what Mark's doing over there in India. And thanks for letting me run the show today, and thanks for the great conversation. And we will see you all, let's see, in I think 2 weeks, July or June 17th. Is the next CTW call. I'm sure we'll see a lot of you before then, but thanks a lot for your time, and we'll see y'all in a couple of weeks.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.